a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways. I'm waiting for your day. Till I am a soul on fire. Till I am a soul on fire. Soul on fire, Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day, when I am a soul on fire, when I am a soul on fire, Lord, let me burn for you again, let me return to you again. Again, let me return to you again. God, I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire. Lord, I'm longing for your ways, I'm waiting for the day when I am a soul on fire. I'm running for your heart, I'm running for your heart, till I am a soul on fire, Lord, till I am a soul on fire, till I am a soul on fire.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I move. I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you
All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow. Whom you love, I'll love. Love you, serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow.
Today we light the joy candle. Joy is the daughter of gratitude that overflows in our hearts unexpectedly. Sometimes our joy pours out in a smile or laughter. Sometimes it's in a song or a hug. Joy is a gift, and it is also an expression of a humble person who knows that they have a life that they don't deserve. The mother of Jesus was the first person to express joy as the gift of God in Jesus Christ. Her words are sealed in Scripture. Try to imagine how they poured out of her heart spontaneously. My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. May your experience in joy this day, may you experience joy this day in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the greatest of gifts, and in you we have a wellspring of joy. Humble us this season and give us thankful hearts. Bubble up in us the power of joy that we might sing, smile, and laugh when we think of your mercies toward us. We pray all of this in your holy name. Amen.
I want to be close, close to your side, so heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one. Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, great I am. Who is worthy? None beside thee. God Almighty, the great I am.
I want to be near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I want to see dry bones living again, singing as one. Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, great I am. Mountains shake before you, the demons run and flee, as the mention of your name, King of Majesty. There is no power in hell, or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am, the great I am, the great I am. Holy, holy God Almighty, great I am. Who is worthy? None beside thee. God Almighty, great I am. Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, great I am. Worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, great I am, 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 all the great.
Father, we ask now in the name of Jesus Christ that you would walk into this space once again, and that through the power of Jesus, that your train would fill this room, as Isaiah said. He was in the temple one day, and he noticed how grand you were, Father, that the true worship is occurring right now as we're exalted with Christ into the heavens, that everything we do on earth, Lord, is just a shadow of what's really going on in heaven, Lord, and You, Father, are receiving the prayers, as you always have, of all the saints, of all the martyrs, of all your children on earth. And Father, I think we have a tendency just to throw up prayers and see what happens, or we're doing it out of sheer obligation. But when a bunch of people gather, when a bunch of people in Jesus Christ, not even a bunch of people, just a handful of people who have the faith of a mustard seed or greater in Jesus' name, when these prayers come up, Lord, there's this bowl that you've got up there. It says that you've got this bowl that's being filled with the prayers of the saints. In Jesus' name, may so much prayer, so much praise go up to you in this room right now, in Jesus' name, that the bowl would begin to tip. We know you'll pour out, Father, your activity. You'll pour out your intervention. We pray that December 11th, 2016 would be a day, Father, when the earth would twist, when things would occur to your complete majestic work. And in Jesus' name, that things would turn over, Lord, that the last would be first and the first would be last. We pray in Jesus' name, Lord, that fires that have been burning that aren't from you would go away, and dead candles would rise up and burn aflame again in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, that this would be a house of prayer for all the nations, and that you would receive from this little space right here in Lubbock, Texas, a blasting, a fire hydrant's worth of glory and praise and honor in your throne room. Father, may we mean what we say. May you enable us by the Holy Spirit to hear from your word and rejoice. May we actually commune in Christ today, not just remember him with our heads, but meet him in the Spirit. And in Jesus' name, we pray that this would be a day that is not squandered. We pray this prayer always in the name of Jesus, your Holy Son, who taught the church how to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would you please pass the peace of Christ with your brothers and sisters?
Hallelujah, holy, holy.
Please be seated. The Lord's provided once again, and this is bread for today. Whatever is not eaten will go to waste. You can't eat tomorrow's bread, and you shouldn't eat yesterday's bread. You should eat the daily bread. This morning, we normally have too much bread left over. Don't go overboard. But this morning, as a sign of your hunger for the Lord and your intent to devour every word he gives you, I encourage you to take a bigger piece than you normally do. If we run out of bread, we'll figure it out. But I'll tell you, that's never been our problem. We don't run out. The Lord, on the night he was to face his great work on the cross, his complete obedient submission, where he would first go to the garden and pour out his soul. Blood dripped, it said, like sweat and blood mixed. His soul was to the point of death. If you noticed, after Jesus got up and left the garden, he had already given up his complete will. He was dead in soul so that we could be alive. He was dead in his will so that we could have fresh. He died in the garden. And then Jesus went and faced the whipping post that ripped his flesh and tore him apart. When he stood before Pilate, he gasped at how bad they beat him. He was like a dead body standing there. Jesus died on the whipping post so that by his stripes you would be healed. The only thing keeping him on his feet was his spirit, which he was to commend to the Father on the cross. He was so beaten in body and so bruised in soul that he had to have a man help him carry his cross. The crowds gasped when they saw him pass. And he carried that cross that night, that afternoon, all the way by the power of the Spirit to Golgotha. And it was upon the cross that this man who had died and become sin for us in soul and experienced the beating and the death of the body gave up his spirit. He gave up his connection to the Father. Someone who was united with the Father before the world was made, went through the worst thing he could have ever experienced, was broken fellowship. My God, where are you? Soul, body, and spirit, Jesus experienced so that we could be healed in body by his wounds, so that we could be healed in our emotions and in our mind by his soul bruising, and that we could connect with the Holy Father through the Spirit by giving us a spirit that he gave up. Jesus performed a mighty work that's bigger than we can comprehend. And when we gather today and we take from this bread and we eat of it, we are telling the Father that although we don't understand it, although there's no way for us to comprehend it, it has become the foundation of our very life. Jesus for us, this his body for us. For on the night he was to begin this great work, he gathered his church to celebrate a meal. He took a loaf of bread, he praised the Father for it, and then he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Take, eat, all of you. And every time that you gather and you eat from this bread, remember me." And then Jesus took a cup of wine. He thanked the Father for it, and then he said, "This cup has become the new covenant, the new relationship that we have with God. And it has been poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins for many people. Drink of it, all of you. And every time that you gather and you drink from this cup, remember me." Let us pray.
Gracious God, thank you again that we are in your house this morning and that we have received, all of us here, the invitation to your table, where during this season we remember also the child, the Christ child, and that this adorable child was brought here for us so we could learn about the great love you had for us and which you exampled when your son gave his life on the cross, his body broken, nailed to the cross, his blood spilling. So as we take this bread and this cup, we remember this, that it was done for us, for our transgressions, and that we might have a chance for everlasting life, that we follow your son's teachings and do thy will. He asked us to love him and love each other. We pray all this in his son's name. Amen. Amen.
Please come.
Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again.
forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit lives within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love. My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Jesus, you are my King. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you.
Father, we speak now words of children. When we look to you, as Jesus told us to in Luke 11, that you're a good father, and we need to start trusting that. You're not some strange uncle from a foreign country that doesn't speak our language and just has a bunch of money and we're trying to impress. You are as close and as intimate to us as we're ready to let you be. And that you're going to give as much of yourself to your church as we'll get out of the way and let. And so we pray now, Father, a prayer asking for forgiveness. Not from something we did or some sin or word we spoke, but instead, Father, we pray for the forgiveness of the things within us that secretly resist you. The things in our lives that secretly and that we've accommodated, that we don't know about, but they are actually pitted against your work. We pray you would take them. Take away our swords, any instrument of defense. Some of us are very intelligent. Some of us have had success in business. Some of us, just different things have gotten us through life. And this morning we recognize that Jesus said those who live by those things will die by those things. So we lay down our swords. We come to you unarmed. And we want to peek into your glory and hear from you. In full submission, Father, we now pray this prayer and ask that you feed us and gift us from your holy and ancient word. Amen. Hey, Larry. Thank you. It's good to have you, Mark. I know we have some visitors with us today. I met Landon, Curtis, and Jade. Just moved here from Washington State. I like how you have to say state because, you know. God has assembled this body today. People have been here a while, kind of new people. People that have been gone or have come back. And may we recognize that the word he has for us this morning is meant for this body. The bread he's provided for today is for this body. And so I'm up here to preach by the power of the Holy Spirit. And I ask that your heart would be open. He gave me a vision this week that he was going to be giving. He gave me a box and the keys come in it, and I'm to give people keys. And so I stood out in the hallway with my brothers and sisters just now and prayed that God would give a key in the box to every heart in this room, and it would be sent out to unlock every heart so that we could meet God this morning. And so we continue in on a sermon series, and we'll get to our scripture in just a minute. You can probably guess where it's from. ESP, you know. And the sermon and the message we're hearing today comes within a series that lasts 3 weeks. We're on the second of the 3 weeks of the middle sermon. And as we began last week, we started with a topic that God is still speaking to his people as he spoke in the past and as he spoke to the wise men. And the thing that makes someone wise is not their head knowledge. Scripture actually says knowledge puffs up. It's not helpful. It's only helpful if it's helpful, right? You have all these resources. Someone's mentioned to me before that money, for instance, is like a tool, like a hammer. And let's say you go back home and you have a shed with 500 hammers. Awesome. Way to go. It's just a tool. All these things are just tools. They don't add worth and they don't take worth away. Wisdom isn't the accumulation of stuff. Rather, wisdom is being able to take advantage of the moments and the discretion and the discernments that God puts on your heart. To boldly go where no man has gone before. I'm a Wayne's World guy. Sometimes I wish I could go boldly where no one's gone before, but I'll probably just stay in Aurora. But I'll probably just stay in Lubbock. The sense that God is actually calling people to wake up and live their life with his lordship is what we're talking about. And what made the wise men wise wasn't all that they knew and all their connections and how many camels they have. It's that they were the few who actually got up and went when the star appeared. And for the 3 or 4 or 5 or however many went, 10,000 didn't go. What made them wise was that they actually worked with the knowledge given. Jesus said a parable. A man had 2 sons. In the morning he went to them and said, "Who will help me work in the field?" And one of them said, "I will go." And the other said, "I will not." The first son who said, "I will go," changed his mind and never went. And the one who said, "I will not go," changed his mind and went. Who did the will of the Father? That's what we're talking about. Actually walking with the Lord. And so this series includes 2 big assumptions that I asked us to test drive. I asked for 3 weeks, but I'm really asking for 6 months because you really got to test drive the car longer than 3 weeks. And the two assumptions are, number one is that God is speaking to his people. There is a false doctrine that got into the church. It's actually been in the Stone Campbell movement with us. I didn't realize it until I was reading up on it. Started back in the late 1700s. And it came about because the church was being filled with the Holy Spirit in some areas, and it made the churchy McChurch church people scared. The Frozen Chosen, of which I am a proud member. It made us scared, you see. And so this doctrine called secessionism began that said that the Holy Spirit acted powerfully the first couple generations of the church, particularly through the apostles, and then it breathed further so that the Bible could be canonized. Once the Bible was written and canonized, the New Testament, the Holy Spirit ceased to speak like it did in the past. The purpose of the Holy Spirit, this doctrine, false doctrine teaches, is to produce the Bible so that your new Trinity becomes the Father, Son, and Holy Bible. That's not right. The Trinity is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Spirit breathed the Scriptures, and the Spirit speaks through the Scriptures. But even if the Bibles all disappeared, we would still have the living Word of God. His name is Jesus. I'm a Bible guy, but we also need to be spirit people. So the doctrine of secessionism said that all you need to know is your Bible. Well, I know plenty of people that know the Bible that are lost in life. We call it paralysis by analysis. It's become the new works righteousness, where we go to enough Bible studies, we go to enough sermons, and we go to enough, you know, whatevers, and then God owes me something, and so God's going to bless my life. That's works righteousness. We put in, we get out. That's not how this works. So next week we're going to drive home. I really want you to be here next week, because that's the last sermon's always the best one, I think. But today we're going to be talking about that these two assumptions in better detail to test them. So the first assumption is that God actually does still speak to his people. He does still give people dreams. He speaks perfectly timed messages that will not go against Scripture, but it doesn't have to be while you're reading the Bible. And I've got plenty of testimony that happened recently in the fellowship of God almost grabbing us by the shoulders and shaking us, you know. Pay attention. Because I love you. I'm not abusive. So, trust me. So, number one is that God still speaks. Say, God still speaks.
God still speaks.
Okay, very good. You may go. Number two is the assumption that God is better at life than we are. God still speaks, and God's better at life than we are. That's an important assumption because, as we just prayed, many people do not believe that. The people who have the hardest time trusting in the Lordship and the promptings of the Lord, of Jesus Christ, are people who have had temporary success using other things besides the Lord. Jesus said, it's easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for who to go to heaven? A rich man. Women, y'all are good. Rich men are in trouble, you see. It's difficult. Now, Jesus is not talking about going to heaven or hell. St. Peter said, Lord, we left everything behind to follow you. And God said, I tell you what's impossible for people is possible for God. So we're not talking about going to heaven. We're talking about living heavenly now. We're talking about walking. The Scriptures call the Holy Spirit, the down payment, the guarantee of the Holy Spirit is the guarantee of heaven. You get to walk in heaven today. We're going to talk a lot about that next week, this concept of the game clock versus real time. I could do some basketball stuff next week. Remember, I want to be a ref. Oh, whoa. Awesome. It's like I'm having a moment now. So you've got two assumptions. The first one is difficult for people who feel like we can predict and control God. And that's the idea that God can speak. God is free to speak. And if you don't feel like you're hearing from the Lord, it is not because he's not speaking. It's because you have scales on your eyes, or you've got clogged up ears, or you just don't care to listen. Because we all, the greatest sin we have is our consistent, built-in, undiagnosed resistance to the Father. We have built up issues in our heart. We call that almost a heart attack, you know, where it starts to clot up and then you die one day. That's what we got going on. We don't know it until it's diagnosed and we're free. Most people don't know what a pain-free existence feels like until they're pain-free. They don't realize, oh, how much pain I had. That's what we're talking about. That's why you go to the Lord and ask Him to forgive the resistance we have built in to hear His voice. Number two is the issue of temporary success. Pray to the Lord very carefully, not to evil, but to the Lord, that He would continue to keep you humble. Tim McGraw, right? Humble and kind. Be humble. He will send you perfectly timed thorns in your side that is intended to keep you from being conceited, to continue to keep you desperate for His leadership. A preacher that has a big church, what's the big problem? Pride. They'll start to preach to keep the church big. A businessman that's trying to follow the Lord that has a big breakthrough in business, or businesswoman, let's be cool here, right? Has a big breakthrough in business, and that could be the best years of their life, but in spirit, that could actually be the most distracting, paranoid, graspy, and calloused years of our lives. And so we have to confess that God is better at living our lives than we are. What God is handing you for free is better than any collection of variables that would make up a cool life in your mind. What God hands you blows out of the water what you think a good life would look like. Not only does He know what it is, He can provide for that life, and He's glorified in that life. And so this morning we're talking about how do you test the signs that you hear from the Lord? If God indeed is actually, if you're going to test drive this and say, okay, I'm going to go down this rabbit trail with Pastor Paul, but I'm going to hold on to the rip because I don't like it. I can go back, right? But I'm going to go down the path and spelunk down into here. And while we're here, I'm going to start encountering signs. I'm going to start having dreams. Some of you have already told me about the dreams you've been having. 3 or 3:30 in the morning, if you keep getting awakened right then, please actually go put water on your face and actually wake up because you're being favored, even though it doesn't feel like it. You're up in the middle of the night. You're favored. Wake up and then tell the Lord, I'm awake and I really want to hear from you. People are having dreams or having experiences. This is the harvest that God is beginning to birth in the church. When you start having signs, the number one question most people are going to ask is, how do I know that this is a sign from the Lord and not a sign from my ego or from my pride or from the devil or from the world? Because it's real noisy. We know in the end, the Bible says that the world's going to get really noisy. And then Jesus says, here's the trick. My sheep know my voice and they listen when I call. And so this practice of walking and learning how to discern signs doesn't just give you an awesome encounter with the Lord and get to follow in better obedience. It gives you a skill and ability to start listening for His voice. And as I mentioned when we started the series, most things start small and get big. Discernment starts big and gets small. He gets your attention and He teaches us how to listen to Him on big things, like how to start a photography business, a big thing, right? And then He'll get you to the point where you can be laying in bed in the morning and say, Lord, instead of me just autopiloting it, I'm going to wake up and I'm going to praise You in bed and thank You for keeping me alive and for watching over my family. And I'm going to lay here for a minute and ask You to tell me when to get up. And then I'm going to walk into my closet. Actually, I'm going to go to the bathroom first. Then brush my teeth. Then I'm going to walk to my closet. And I am going to ask You, Lord, I'm going to pick up my clothes. I'll give You a second here. Is there anything You would like me to wear today? I did that this morning. So you start big and you get small. And I'm here to tell you, and I don't know what you've been told, nothing is too trivial for the Lord. Nothing is too trivial for the Lord. Go read the Bible. Look at the nitpicky stuff the Lord follows in. All the signs. Go lay a little piece of cloth and watch the dew. Watch what it does. And then go all the from the big things to the little things, people started submitting to the living Lord. And so that's where this leads, is being able to discern the voice of the Lord so that you can be someone who doesn't just know their Bible or attends a church, But in your generation, you can be like a shining star in a perverse time. It's really cool. And if you're older, I don't want to look at anybody. I don't want to hurt anyone. If you're older, a saying I heard recently is the best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time is today. There's going to be a tendency if you're older to really disregard the work of the Lord because you regret and you deny Him because of how long you haven't been walking in this way. It's difficult. It's hard. Best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. Second best time is today. So I'm encouraging you to walk in this today. Learn the voice of the Lord. So there's five things I wanted to throw out today the Lord put on my heart to help filter if you're hearing a sign from the Lord or from something else, a false source. And because the enemy, you got to be careful, is very deceptive. We know that he is the father of all lies. He's a deceiver. His native language is lying. He's fluent in it. He could write poetry in lying. He's a wonderful liar, which is awful. And we're not most, when you're led astray, when you get involved in something, it's not because you think it's bad. I'll put it that way. Deception means you thought it was good. Eve ate of the fruit because of how good it looked. That's how deception works. So I've discerned five filters I want to give you today and start applying to test the signs you think you're seeing. The first filter, and this is pretty much next week's sermon, so we're just going to fly on it real quick. The first filter is that if God is giving you a sign, if God's getting your attention, it will be connected to God's glory, and it will be connected to who you are in eternity. It will be connected to God's glory, and it will start revealing who you are in eternity. Some of us will be dancers. Some people in eternity, they will look at the Lord's glory and then paint a picture. You know, we're not monolithic in heaven, right? We're diverse, all nations. It's beautiful. And God gets to reveal who you are in eternity. As you walk by the designs of the Lord, as you learn, for instance, God has made me a lead singer. God has made me to be someone who cries with the seraphim and cherubim, holy, holy, holy. God has made me an elder. My job is to throw crowns. God, this is what I do. God's starting to show me that I hand out keys. I'm going to be handing out keys. I thought I was a builder. He's like, nope, you unlock the building. Okay, that's cool. So whatever your thing is, God starts to reveal who you are going to be in eternity. As you follow down the signs, you live into that. He starts chiseling you away from the rock so that your eternal life can kind of start now. You start living into your design today. Remember, is there life after death? Sure. Is there life before death? Yes. You can start today. Walking with the Lord, He shows you who He is and who you are. It's so awesome. Filter number one, God's glory, who you are in eternity. And you know, we should start treating each other like we're going to be when we are in eternity. Brothers and sisters, you're not doing anyone any favors by hiding who you are. We need you. Christ is still coming. All these things are, we're good there, but in terms of the walk of the kingdom people on earth right now, the more and the quicker you can learn by following obedient signs, the more you become who you are, it's going to be so much better for your brothers and sisters in Christ. Number two, if you're following the Lord, oh, horn frogs. Okay. Collect. Okay. If you're following the Lord, it will require faith to follow Him. And He will give you that faith. It will require faith. Faith is the churchy word for trust and confidence and resilience. You know, Christians are these weird people that just, the only thing, here's a Christian. We're attracted to God and we don't have give up in us. We're not exceptional at first. God can do exceptional things in us as we mature. But faith is the ability to stand firm and walk through things that you wouldn't otherwise walk through. It's a gift from God. It is not a human product. It's not a choice. It's a gift. You go out every morning and you gather it like manna. Go gather the faith God is giving you for the next steps. God will give you the faith to follow him. Because of God's glory and the way God's signs work, signs are going to require faith because it's going to go directly in contrast to the path you've been on. You have to walk up a river that's flowing against you at first. If you're going to be following God, it's going to be not the path of least resistance. It's going to be, as Jesus said, the path that few find that looks really hard, but it leads to life. And as soon as you take a step on it, you realize it's not as hard as I thought because God is the one providing for me. People who do not follow signs are going to do the way that's honoring the natural progression of human regression, where you're selfish and you're scared and you do things out of weird ulterior motives and you can't stand it when people don't like you and whatever the thing is, you're going to walk down this path, and whatever you walk down that path toward, you're going to find your new God, and it ain't Jesus. The fruit of that path is not satisfying. And it's ruled by something we've made accommodation for that's keeping us from hearing from the Lord and taking the first step. And it's the, you know when I say it, it's the basic, shared, accommodating spirit that we allow into our lives. It's called fear. I walk the halls of this fellowship, this sanctuary and facility once a week now in evict fear. And I love it. This was revealed to me recently. Fear, the problem with fear isn't how powerful it is. Fear is actually not that powerful. Fear, if you were to personify fear, like if fear is a demon, fear itself is afraid. The problem with fear isn't that it's powerful. The problem with fear is that we've communally, in terms of the human race, we've made wide accommodation for it. The things we don't do, and the things that come out of us, out of fear, to discourage people from following the Lord. It's amazing. Fear-based preaching. You don't want to go to hell, do you? What? Fear-based preaching. Fear-based teaching. Fear-based advice. We honor it so much that if you're going to be following the Father, you have to come to terms with the fact that he will be causing you to walk on water. He's going to get you to do something out of faith that goes in direct contrast with what you're afraid of. I've told you before, and I'm going to tell you again, there are two great fears in the United States of America. The first one is public speaking. The second one is death. The first one is public speaking. The second one is death. So if you're at a funeral, you'd rather be in the casket than giving the eulogy. Isn't that crazy? That's how false this is. It's not good. It needs to be gone. My greatest fear before entering into ministry was public speaking. I'm going to repeat that publicly while I'm speaking. My greatest fear was public speaking. And I told the Father, the signs need to be awfully strong because I will let my fear of speaking keep me from doing this. And when he called me to First Christian Church Lubbock, I was sitting in a sanctuary in Dallas, Texas, looked a lot like this chapel, and I told God, because I'm George Bailey. I'm good old George Bailey. I'm a loyal guy. I told the Father that my loyalty to Highlands Christian Church in Dallas, Texas is so strong, and I want to be known as the guy that even though the church was small, even though we didn't really have a youth group, even though this, even though that, Paul stuck with us for 25 years. That was my identity. Loyal Paul. George Bailey. And so I had to go to the Father and say, my fear of disappointing these people will keep me from following you to Lubbock or wherever you're taking me. I don't know. And so the signs need to be strong for me, Father. I confessed my fear. So if the Lord's calling you to a major thing in your life, changing majors or moving somewhere or moving from Washington State to Texas or whatever the thing is, go to the Father and be willing to talk openly with Him about the things that paralyze you. Because He will call you to do things and watch Him conquer those things that have been keeping you from walking those paths. But the only way you'll follow Him and the only way you'll deal with that, the only way you'll walk out on the water is if you have become convinced that up to this point, He's been good to you. And He's been providing for you, and He's gotten you to this path. And beyond the water is so much glory. Beyond your fear of public speaking, there's so much to do. You're gonna have 2 weeks where you're like, I'm not afraid of public speaking anymore. You know, like, this is cool. But he's gonna push you and say, okay, great, awesome. Next, and then push you to the next thing. If you live scared, you'll worship a dead God. God will call you. He will split the sea. He will provide at the last minute. He will call you down a path where your swords don't work anymore. He will weaken you because He's going to be strong when you're weak. That's number two. It will require faith. It will not be comfortable. It won't be easy. This is not a prosperity gospel. You don't sit on your tush and hope and receive. You follow in obedience. And when God's going to be glorified in your life, and when you're linked to who you are in eternity, that's when it starts to flow. That's when you start to find out how good He is. Number three, if you're hearing from the Lord, you're having dreams at night, and you're having signs and things are lining up, and every time you open the Bible, it has the word harvest or whatever the thing is, God will send you discerning people who will help you sharpen that vision. You do not have to discern this alone. These will not be people who have an axe to grind or who are fear-based. They also will not be flattering and tell you how awesome you are when you're not. These are people who are committed also to listen to the Lord. And you'll find yourself, if you're walking under signs and of the Lord's voice, you will be used by God to help other people discern what He's doing in their life. God provides a vision and then a people. And with the people comes more vision and more people. That's how churches form. It grows together. That's what we're experiencing. God will send you people. You do not have to do this alone. But you also need to be sure that when you're doing this with people, you're not following God or following signs for their approval. Scripture says in Proverbs 15, in wise and wide counsel, there is safety. He will send you safety once you start exploring to see if that bush is actually burning. Number four, if you're following the peace of Jesus, if you're following signs, it will accompany the peace of Jesus Christ. If you're following God, including walking on water and conquering fears, if you're following God and changing locations and going and grieving. By the way, a lot of times when you're following God, you have to grieve. I had to grieve no longer being an engineer. I had to grieve. You just do. Get over it. I don't want to say that. Let God heal your heart. Deal with it. Go to God. Walk with Him in it. It hurts. It's scary. There's all the emotions wrapped up in that. Someone will tell you it's either me or that, and you got to say that. And then you got to grieve. Because you probably don't want someone in your life that's going to build an ultimatum like that. Or your parents may disown you. Or, I don't know, who knows. But it's amazing that when you follow the Lord, how much difficulties will come your way to keep you from following the Lord. And at the same time, how much peace will wash through you. Peace is the churchy word for being put back together. It's called shalom, or being whole. You don't know where you're going. You don't know why you're here, but you know who you are. I have a wife that knows the Lord. And it's great to be married to someone who knows the Lord because she knows who she is. I never wonder with my wife. She works at a bank. She's all over the place. She's having friends and all. I don't know who she's with. I don't know what she's doing. but I know who she is. The peace of the Lord produces such character in a person that we're no longer tossed to and fro. We're not chameleons where we just fall in line with what everyone's doing. It's a strength. Peace is known as this like cheap, hallmarky thing. No, it's not cheap and hallmarky. It's sovereign. It's strong. It's a gift that says, no matter if I'm wherever I live, even if I move on missions to the Middle East and I'm living in a full-on world where everyone's making fun of Jesus and all this stuff, I get to know who I am. I know who I am. The peace of Jesus comes with the signs. And you'll know it's strange because you're doing stuff you haven't done before and yet you know who you are more. It's counterintuitive. I know who I am. The peace of Jesus. And number five, if you're following the Lord, if he's prompting you to go down a path and you're just bebopping along and then you have some difficulties and then you celebrate, you do the dance because you do public speaking and then you're going down along, what you will find very quickly is if you really are following the Lord, is that he is able to love this nation, these people, his children, much more freely through you than he has in the past. It just flows out of you. You're not even trying. You're busy obeying God, and people are getting loved on by the Lord. Scott and I were with three pastors from Amarillo, and We meet with pastors once every 6 weeks to build relationships within the denomination, and they were down here at Orlando's. I didn't even read the scripture. I'll get to that. We were at Orlando's, and we were having a great time together. We have very different backgrounds, and First Amarillo is starting to experience what we're experiencing. It's great to see. And while we're out talking, we get to know the waiter pretty well, and all these signs are lining up. Scott's been talking about lions. Was it loins or lions? Lions? Okay. One letter, you know. And the guy had a big lion tattoo. All these things were lining up. And then somebody, like, it was a group discernment. Hey, did you see that tattoo? Then he came back, and I engaged him, and he said his father was actually a pastor and a church start, and I jumped out of my comfort zone and said, can I have his name and number, please? Like, okay, who asked their waiter for their dad's name and number? I'm going to tell on you, you know. But he gave me his name and number. I put in my phone, and we continued to talk, and you know how preachers are. They get real, we're blowhards. We get real loud, and ugh, preachers are so self-serving, I don't know, sometimes. But and so you had that going on, and all of a sudden, Barry next to me, this big den, and I was just kind of sitting in it, and Barry said to me, we need to get better at listening. And it was silent. And then he said, to the Lord. We need to get better at listening to the Lord. And then I was washed in that. I was like, okay. And I was washed in that moment. The Lord told me to sow into Tim. Our waiter. Sow into Tim. He's a fertile field. Put seed into Tim. Put something into this guy. Sow into Tim. And he's a 20-year-old guy. I don't know much about his background. I said, okay. All right. So I opened up my wallet and I put everything I had in there. It was $4. Have mercy on me. I put $4 on the table, emptied my wallet, and he came forward and I testified to him. I said, I don't know what all this is, but these $4, the Lord has told me to sow into you, so I'm sowing into you, and that's that. And so he was shocked, and all these things happen. I pray over him, and there's the eye of the lion. I think I shared this with many of y'all. It was all this weird stuff. But we get back to First Christian Church, and I call up his dad after doing a few things in the office, and his dad was on the phone, jumping up, like all excited and cryy and gaspy, and he said his son Tim had just said that five men came in and sowed into him, and he wanted to know what that meant. Well, his dad had been praying for years for his son to encounter godly men who were not related to him that would come out of the blue, like the wise men. What? It's hit me. Praise the Lord. So we did that, and now he's excited. The dad's excited. So And the Lord put on my heart to meet with him even before the sowing, because I knew I got his phone number, because I knew the Lord was telling me to meet with him to talk with him about ministry. So I came over with Scott to give this guy a book. His name is Fabian Davila. And we go all the way over to his place of business, and he comes out. He's a little guy, and he's real strong, and he almost breaks my shades when he hugs me too hard. And he is crying. Scott was there. He's crying. He was beaming. He was excited. And he said that when he got the note from his son, the text from his son that some men just sowed into him, he wanted to jump up and down, and he wanted to celebrate and testify, and he didn't have anyone to do it with. And we knew we were supposed to go, so he was kind of holding on to this for 45 minutes until we got there. And now he's jumping up and down, and he's so excited, and he's beaming, and he's crying, and he's giving hugs. And the Lord was at work in his life. The fifth filter says, if you're following the Lord, he's going to do what through you? Love. If I wanted to love Fabian, if I wanted to go love Fabian, if I went to him and I told him God loves him and I wrote him a nice note and I complimented him and I built him up and I tried really hard, that would not have accomplished what happened. I didn't choose to go love Fabian. I chose to obey the Father. And when you obey God, behold, he loves people through you. Your love is nothing. It's trash. It's conditional. It's weird. It's sinful. It's weird. I don't know. Just, it's not good. It ain't bad, but it's just not heavenly. The world doesn't need any more of the world's love. If we obey God, if we follow God, if we let him get a hold of us, and we'll talk more about that. Come back next week. This is the whole sermon next week. If we do that, you'll notice that love is pouring into people's hearts because you're following the Father. You can't love Fabian like he needs to be loved. Parents, you want to have an experience with your kids? If you want them to be loved by you, follow God. Don't focus on your kids. Focus on your Father. That's the trick. That's the trick. Finding a people, a resurrected church, a revived people across this world who know the voice of the shepherd. And Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey me. If you've had breakthroughs with God, if you're so grateful, if you heard from, I don't know, something this week and you thought, man, I'm so grateful for what Jesus did for me and what he's doing for me and how providing he is and grateful, just so grateful for him. If you want to do something out of gratitude, Jesus said, here's an idea, obey me. You're a living sacrifice. The problem with living sacrifices is they keep crawling off the altar. Stay on the altar. Obey me. If you obey me, you will live. If you obey me, people will be loved. If you obey me, you'll experience heaven. Ball's in your court. I've poured out my spirit. I've given my son. I've given you all sorts of messages. Might as well read the Bible, but I won't today because it's not in my heart. Go see if the bush is burning. If you keep getting waken up at 3:30, obey God by saying, well, my preacher keeps saying 3:30. So I'm going to say, I'm paying attention. Speak to me, Lord. If you want miracles in your life, if you want to live, if you want marvelous things before you die, this is not a heaven and hell sermon. I'm talking about today. If you want to experience life, if you want to experience the Lord, it's the ball's in your court. We are overeducated and under-obedient. Be wise. Be wise in the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we speak these words now as children who long to spend more time walking in real life. Jesus is the only person who's ever been born whose physical life, all the time they had, the 33 years he lived, completely matched his spirit walk. He didn't waste a second. And Father, we confess to you that we could be 80 years old but only 2 weeks old in the Lord. Because we keep stepping out of bounds, we keep forgetting your word, we keep not listening to you. In Jesus' name, we pray that we would live so much more for the rest of our lives. We pray that today we would be new. We would be renewed. We would have a gift of sight and sound where we can move in your spirit. And in Jesus' name we pray that you would bless this fellowship this morning with not only signs, but courage. Break us out, Father, of the things that keep us betraying you and grieving your spirit. Forgive us our sins, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Countless people are loved and countless things occur because a group of ragtags, a group of people in fellowship stopped resisting you and said yes to you. In Jesus' name we pray for this. Amen. Please rise as we sing. I'll be in the back if anyone would like prayer. Father, we ask you continue to bless and keep us. We pray, Father, that your ways would be evident to us, that you would send us signs and messages. You would surround us with discerning voices that can be encouraging to us to follow you We pray, Father, that our ears would learn and we would adjust abilities, Father, to spend more time and in more ways walking in your Spirit. We pray this always in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, as we close up, there's just two things, I think two. Number one, we learned this week that our own Betty McNeil has passed away. Betty had a 7-year issue with Alzheimer's, and so the family's grateful that she's walking in the kingdom now. Her services will be 2 o'clock on Friday. I'm not sure if it's in here or in the sanctuary. Last day we have for poinsettias and beans, so if you would like to participate in that, fill that out and get it to me or Scott after service. And I think that's it. The main thing is, I know there's a lot of traveling, some college students. If you're going to, this is your last Sunday, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. We'll see you in the new year. Some of you aren't leaving. We'll see you next week. Hope you can make it. And please join me for our benediction. And now may the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and shine his glory upon you and grant you the peace of his Son, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,